Did you know that Filipinos spend the most time on social media? In 2019, Filipinos spent as much as 4 hours and 1 minute on average on social media networks per day versus the global average of just 2 hours and 23 minutes. This morning, we talked to the founder of the social media apps that's eating up a lot of her time, Kumu Roland Ross. Hi, Roland. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, how are you?
Good, good. So, Roland, I know that you started as a messaging app and then became a live streaming social media platform. That really says a lot about the evolving interests of people. But when you look ahead, when you look forward, what do you think is the next evolution going to look like? What's the next level of self-expression going to be?
Yeah, well, you know, one of the key things in terms of evolution are the changes that are happening from a system-wide perspective. So one thing is looking at markets. And so when you look at the market right now, specifically in the Philippines, most of the market now, the median age is actually Gen Z and millennial. So that's one specific thing is, do you have a market of at least 100 million people who have a median age that leans younger? Because when you look at new social platforms, that's actually where social platforms actually lean. And then secondly is really billions of dollars being spent on internet infrastructure. So although a lot of people tend to be somewhat dismissive of the Philippine internet, if you actually look at the amount of investment that's going on, all you need is really 1 gigabyte upload, 1 megabyte download for streaming to actually happen. So in a 3G environment, right, when we became the capital of texting, it was texting. But in a 4G LTE environment, it's really about video. And then as we go into 5G, it's the live streaming. So really, it's about the evolution of the infrastructure that allows platforms to go. And then thirdly is, right, so here you have an iPhone that costs a lot of money, but because of Vivo, Oppo, Realme, Xiaomi, Huawei, you have phones that have iPhone specs for only $100. And so when you have an affordable smartphone at 3 gigabyte RAM and 32 gigabyte hard drive for only $100, you see this is a perfect storm of new types of ways for people to engage.
Okay. So one of the unique things about Kumu is that viewers can gift live streamers with things that can eventually be converted into cash. So viewers can cash in and buy coins, they can gift. Aside from that, the cash-in part, make us understand the business model. I mean, where do you and your investors make money from this?
Yes, so I think one of the key things is really focusing on the community. And by focusing on the community, there's a lot of opportunities for a business model to be sustainable and scalable. So what you're talking about is what we call the microtransaction business, where we do earn a revenue share. And because of the amount of purchases that do occur globally, you know, we became the number one highest grossing social app in the Philippines. But because of the global nature of Filipinos around the world, we were the number 10 highest grossing social app in Canada, number 5 in the UAE, number 4 in Australia and New Zealand, and as well as like number 7 in Hong Kong, number 8 in Norway, number 9 in the United Kingdom. And it's because of the revenue share that we have from these microtransactions. But in addition to that, we also earn a commission for e-commerce purchases that do occur on Kumu, as well as brand partnerships with, you know, partners like Globe to Grab and Ancas, where they actually, and Food Panda has been a great partner where they do advertise to have these authentic conversations with our Gen Z and millennial base.
So right now, Roland, you've got over 7 million users on the platform, visiting 60 million times per month. Wow. And you're just about to hit the 3-year mark, correct? What's the next goalpost? I mean, how much bigger are you seeing Kumu, let's say in the next 3 to 5 years? How much more money are you putting in as well? I know that you've raised a little over $6 million, including your recent Series A, where you raised $5 million. How much are you planning to raise for Series B this year, I understand?
Yeah, so, well, right now, you know, we're being a little shy about the actual amount, but it is definitely, when you do close a Series B, it's definitely a significant step up of the previous Series A, and we're very grateful to our investors. And I think for long-term goals really is to build the sustainable consumer internet business where we really want to be the number one consumer internet company in the Philippines. So similar to what you've seen with Kakao building an app ecosystem in Korea, to what Gojek did in Indonesia, and what really inspires us is VNG Corporation in Vietnam. So beyond the live streaming, it's, you know, a mobile gaming component. There's e-commerce, obviously. Mm-hmm. Then there's also a financial technology component. So I think for us, it's really to focus on the community, which we see a lot of growth towards closer to a 20 million active users when all is said and done at the minimum. And then at the same time, when you have a community that size, there's a lot of opportunity beyond just the live streaming component, but into other consumer internet opportunities.
Well, that's very exciting times ahead for sure for Kumu. Roland, we want to get to know you more. Let's do a fast talk round very quickly, a quick Q&A. Okay, so let's start. Being from Silicon Valley, you moved back to the Philippines, inspired by Philippine ambassador to the U.S., Jose Cuisha, to come home. What's the most unforgettable thing he said to you?
You know, the one of the key things when he was the ambassador was really this, like, him telling me, you know, because before I was mostly engaged in humanitarian and community mm-hmm. service work. And when he said that maybe creating technology jobs in the Philippines is the best way that you can give back. And that really inspired me. And also our first advisor, his name is Dato Banatao. Yeah, and so when Dato was talking about building this ecosystem of technology and innovation for the Philippines, and that's the best way that we can give back. Because prior to that, I was mostly doing, you know, a clean water project or a poverty alleviation, you know, those types of things, which is all good and great. And I think, though, that when you have mentors like Dato, or where you have leaders like Ambassador Cuisha, really having to reframe my mind and thinking, it was very inspired by the challenge and the adventure to do that.
So, okay, very quickly, a few more questions. What's the strangest Kumu live streamed ever, in your opinion, of course?
One of the craziest things I ever saw was someone on Kumu running into someone who was on Kumu. Into each other. That was the funniest thing.
Okay.
Another one was someone tattooed our mascot on their leg. That was another one, too.
And who's Carlito? Carlito is the name of your Blue Tarsier mascot. Why Carlito?
Carlito is actually the scientific name of a Tarsier. So if you actually Wikipedia, it's a Carlito Siracta is the scientific name. And so we just call it Carlito, yeah.
One thing that has surprised you about the business or the market?
I think it's the passion and the creativity of Filipino.
Is exit an option? You know, a lot of startups make money with exits. Is this the
Yeah, absolutely. I think for us, we really want to build an IPO-able worthy company. And so basically the implication means we have the option to go public, or at the same time, the implication is if you build a company that is IPO worthy, that means, you know, we're employing a ton of people, we're empowering thousands of creators, and we built a community that's sustainable and that's very strong in the minds of our investors. So yeah, I think we would be open to it as long as it really helps the community and really strengthens the connections that we've been able to build.
One last question very quickly. What's a realistic timetable for when you will be IPO-able?
I think right now, after we close our Series B, there's obviously the goals that we need to hit to what they call open up a big significant growth round. Mm-hmm. And that growth round is very similar to, congratulations to what GCash just experienced this year. So something of along that side that really prepares the company to double down on those scalable adjacent business
happening in the next 3 years?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I would be doing a terrible job if it doesn't happen in the next 3 years.
Okay, on that note, Roland, thank you so much for joining us, and congratulations. Good luck in your endeavors.
Awesome, thank you.